There we go.
The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to EPC Group's SharePoint 2010 Reality Webinar Series. This is the first of six webinars. Today's webinar is entitled SharePoint in the Now. We will be having five additional follow-up webinars all throughout the months of March, April, and May. Our goal here within EPC Group is to provide real-world, in-the-trenches type consulting and webinar type information to be able to not only help you with your existing projects, but to really help you scope out any possible 2007 and 2010 initiatives, possibly those of you who are looking to replace your existing content management systems or private or government organizations who are really looking at doing a technology refresh and getting into the Microsoft stack and seeing what SharePoint can do for your organization. Today's webinar will run an hour and 15 minutes. We will have questions that will take place at the end of the webinar. Please direct all questions to mprice@epcgroup.net, and we will try to answer it as many as possible. So getting started, this webinar is going to cover a lot of document management, a lot of what we are seeing SharePoint right now. Basically, within our different projects that we have going on in flight with the different clients and different customers that we speak with at our different events, really looking at, again, what are folks wanting to use SharePoint for? What are some of the challenges that they're experiencing, and how can really SharePoint help your organization? And not only how can it save budget, but also improve productivity and deliver true ROI within your organization. Skipping ahead. About EPC Group, we're one of the nation's oldest and largest SharePoint implementation firms. We offer enterprise content management-based systems around SharePoint, really offering SharePoint as a hybrid solution on both intranet, extranet-facing solutions, on both WSS and MOS, as well as SharePoint Server 2010 and SharePoint Foundation 2010. We do a lot of health check and assessment initiatives for those organizations out there that may have previous experience with SharePoint, whether it be 2003, 2007, they may be having performance issues, or maybe implemented SharePoint in a way where proper planning wasn't quite done. Maybe there was deadlines, maybe there was just really a lack of internal knowledge, and it's amazing how many sandboxes and pilot environments within SharePoint can end up turning into full-blown production environments with mission-critical data. It's a very common thing that we run across every day. We do offer support contracts, supporting existing implementations throughout Fortune 500 and government clients throughout the U.S. and Canada. We do develop custom applications, web parts, security models, migration initiatives, again, from 07 to 2010, and looking at really from an agnostic standpoint. Can you use the database attach type upgrade option? Is a third party needed because you have customization within your master pages or within your interface or really from your backend as well? Looking at KPIs, dashboards, reporting solutions, within Microsoft Performance Points, looking at possibly replacing SQL reporting services, or if you have other Crystal reports or business objects, BOXI, or even how to integrate those types of systems with SharePoint. We do offer full tailored training. We offer both on-site and remote, really to all different levels of training. And our training that we pride ourselves on is really, again, it's consulting based in the trenches training, where it's not really a tailored, or sorry, not just a canned set of a Microsoft curriculum where we go through and just tell you what, you know, again, what the book says or what the manuals say from Microsoft, but really what we've experienced in the field, what pitfalls you can avoid throughout your engagement.
I just wanted to let you know that for those folks that are attending and myself, we're still sitting in the screen where we just see the intro, so we're not seeing any slides come through.
Correct. Yeah. It should. It looks like there was a little gap there, so we should be able to see the screen there. So going into about EPC Group, we do have offer enterprise metadata design. Going into full-blown retention schedules, full-blown metadata design, and as well as the webpartgallery.com, which is our showcase site out there. A little bit more information about EPC Group. I founded EPC Group back in 1999. It is, again, we've done a little over 600 implementations throughout SharePoint 2001, 2003, 2007 and 2010. We were on the TAP program for both SharePoint 2007 and 2010, as well as Project Server. Based on Microsoft and other input from third-party analysts, we have done more SharePoint implementations than any other firm in the U.S. So jumping into today, again, SharePoint in the Now, looking at implementing a SharePoint Center of Excellence. And this is EPC Group's main methodology, a patent-pending methodology around how we implement Microsoft SharePoint as a primary collaboration content management solution. Again, developing a within our proprietary methodologies, really guaranteeing a reliable, scalable, maintainable implementation that will not only last 6 months, 12 months, 18 months, but really, again, the full life cycle. So it's not a system that you're having to replace or having to modify. We implement these as a hybrid solution so that they can grow over time. So giving a little background on SharePoint and really where EPC Group comes into play. Back in 2000, Tom Rizzo, the head of SharePoint, sent out a press release saying that they have a new technology. It's called Microsoft Tahoe that is going to pretty much change what the content management. And as we look at the timetable, after that, 1 year later, SharePoint Team Services was released. After that, Windows SharePoint Services 2.0 and SharePoint Portal Services back in 2003. Windows SharePoint Services 3.0, WSS 3.0, for which I wrote the book on back in 2007. As well as Moss, which I'm sure a lot of the folks on the phone are still on and are looking to migrate to 2010, as well as SharePoint Foundation 2010, which is basically WSS 4.0. It's the foundation really of everything that is SharePoint, and SharePoint Server 2010, which is the full-blown records management. You have info platform services, Excel services. It's really just one of the more powerful platforms and more powerful tools available in the marketplace. Today, we'll be talking about SharePoint 2010 and, again, real-world case studies around content management, records management, reporting, and how best to utilize SharePoint within your environment. A lot of organizations are looking at enterprise collaboration and saying, how can we connect our people together, whether they're disparate across the U.S. or disparate across the globe. And so once we are really looking at that, how best can we roll out SharePoint to meet those needs? And how can we do it in a secure fashion, whether you're in the private sector or in the government sector, whether it's Department of Defense, whether it's an organization like Continental Airlines. But again, doing that in a way that you're bringing your people together, you're able to really make their job easier. You definitely don't want to roll out a platform that's going to cause them to work longer or challenge them. So the good thing about SharePoint, and one of the major kudos that it gets, it's so easy to use. When you're looking at how people actually collaborate today, going through phones, email, face-to-face file shares, paper-based messaging, fax, and then also social networking. Within that, again, how can SharePoint really help? There's issues and limitations to each one of those, but if you can bring these each together and to be able to bring in being able to do presence indicators, being able to integrate seamlessly with email, being able to do voice chat, migrating in your file shares, scanning your paper-based documents, doing OCR right into SharePoint, the presence indicators and messaging. You can fax right in and fax right out of SharePoint. And then you have the consumer social networks. With SharePoint, there's the My Site capability with SharePoint Server 2010. And really, I'd like to call it professional networking. Again, there is a social component to that, but it really, again, it needs to be very governed. I would say about 60% of our clients roll out My Sites, but that's really around making sure that it's done in a governed manner so that folks are not causing the organization's information to be at risk, HR data, legal data, mergers and acquisitions, all those types of information, as well as some of the issues you might face in healthcare, like PII information, or possibly classified information, or non-classified, or level one data. So, again, they're all best practices within SharePoint, and looking at SharePoint in and out, how these can be addressed, and really how they can be resolved. When we're looking at securely collaborating across organizations, you may want to also be able to integrate your existing data warehouse, other systems. Maybe you have Oracle databases, or you have SAP, or PeopleSoft, or you have possibly a massive Documentum implementation, or a massive OpenText Live Link implementation, and it's just not feasible right now to completely replace that, or maybe you've done this implementation in the last few years. Again, you spent the money on that, but again, SharePoint is just so easy to use, again, it's usability standpoint. From usability standpoint, people much prefer using SharePoint over the Documentums and the Live Links and the file nets of the world. So there are opportunities where you can also front end SharePoint so that you can do a save into SharePoint, and it seamlessly saves into a back-end document or into a back-end Live Link, and it still captures that metadata and retention. But again, SharePoint can wholesale replace those existing systems. Also, it goes across organizational boundaries. So regardless of its multiple languages or across the globe, we have many clients that may have a data center in Chicago and one in Paris. How do you go about doing WAN acceleration? How do you go about being able to upload specific pieces of content? And we can cover all of those items today. Please do submit your questions. SharePoint 2010 is really an IT paradigm shift. Again, we talk to clients every day, and just the other day I was speaking to a large school district, and they were saying, well, you know, we have a new HR system coming in, we have a new financial system coming in, but we also have a mixture of .NET sites, we have a FileNet instance, other clients of ours and other folks we've spoken with at different trade shows or just our meetings we have during the week about talking to them about possible road mapping. All of these systems can be replaced by SharePoint. Documentum, LiveLink, FileNet, WebSphere, eRoom, or DocuShare, any of these existing systems. And really looking at this is, the EPC group has identified about 50 disparate systems that can be seamlessly replaced with SharePoint. And it can be your new intranet, your new knowledge management system. And really, again, this is where we develop SharePoint as a platform so that you don't have to have all of these different systems. You don't have to have a Documentum to do one thing and then also have a disparate intranet system. You can actually have one system that does your intranet, enterprise content management, You're managing your knowledge within that. You're collaborating throughout the organization in secure fashion. You're also possibly doing an internet-facing presence, seeing a lot more internet-facing sites being replaced by SharePoint. And why not have one system that has one backend, a set of hardware, and you have a similar look and feel, you have a similar support audience that's supporting the systems. And you can also bring out extranet-facing solutions to bring in your partners and your customers all the way into that system, even using CAD cards, even using secure IDs, the extranet, and the federation between different organizations. So looking at SharePoint sites and really looking at, again, what's possible in SharePoint 2010, cross-browser support. There are no more issues with, again, whether you have IEs or you have Firefox or Chrome or you're accessing it on a Mac. It is completely cross-browser supported and also mobile. So these SharePoint sites now can be accessed throughout all the different platforms. It does have the very familiar Office 2007 and Office 2010 ribbon in SharePoint 2010. Again, the look and feel and to be able to bring this out to the greater audiences. IE6 is not supported in SharePoint 2010, so that's one thing you do need to keep in mind when thinking about upgrading. Within the SharePoint 2010, SharePoint authoring has been made very simple. You can go in, check out a site, you can modify, edit the site, you can do live previews of sites, you can embed Silverlight movies, Flash movies, you can do live streaming videos. We're seeing a lot with our clients that they want to do training, and they're having basically live streaming training within their SharePoint sites. Again, why fly people all over the country or all over the world to be able to sit in a brick and mortar building and train when you can sit there and do streaming training, track their training, and again, it's just an extremely powerful platform around that. You'll notice down in the bottom right screen, interactive Silverlight. You can bring in Microsoft Performance Point. You can bring in different web parts throughout the platform. And it also has Ajax-based usability. So very similar to like a Google search. You can type in a specific type search, and it'll actually give you complete your search for you. So there's a lot of different pieces here. So Microsoft's goal was to open up a platform so that you don't have to have coding experience, you don't have to be a developer, you can actually utilize SharePoint platform to go out there and be able to utilize this. But also looking at line of business data, you can go right into a SharePoint site and be able to pull in information from your Dynamics system or even from Salesforce, or looking at pulling in information from Oracle, PeopleSoft, SAP, you name it, you can pull it in. There may be some web part integration and a little bit of customization around that, but again, it's extremely incredible to be able to bring in InfoPass forms right into the page via drag and drop, be able to pull in custom line of business data to pre-populate fields, or to be able to really have interactive, taking away the form, paper-based forms, and really putting them into an InfoPass form is something that's extremely powerful. A couple more screenshots here before I get into some a little more granular technical items, but being able to save from SharePoint. Right now we're in PowerPoint. Here's a screenshot of PowerPoint. It's showing who exactly is using SharePoint. There's a presence indicator. I can actually click on Gilden's name and actually IM him if he's available. You can see who he is related to within his My site, who he collaborates with. Again, save this right into SharePoint and fill out the metadata and not have to, again, save it on your file shares, save it on your desktop, and it's now available to the organization. It is extremely powerful, and really it cuts down on the risks of having data on a file share, having data on a desktop, especially in a litigious environment, whether it's e-discovery or whether it's those types of issues, which I'm going to get into here in just a little bit. The SharePoint records management features feature set. In SharePoint 2010, really recordization, in-place records management, metadata-driven hierarchical file plans to be able to actually search for documents based upon document types, e-discoveries and holds to be able to go do legal searches over any SharePoint content, archiving results or leaving them in place. If there's a lawsuit, the lawyers may come in and say, place these specific files on hold or move them into another area or flag them for an audit. It can really help us even Sarbanes-Oxley as well. But really anything can be e-discoverable. And again, I think that in SharePoint 2007, this was not possible to this level. But I would put SharePoint up against Document and LiveLink and FileNet any day of the week to be able to do e-discovery and to be able to do records management with millions or hundreds of millions of documents. It also gives auditing and reporting out of the box to be able to do file plan reports, show your content management policies, showing audit logs, and really doing records retention and expiration. Working with your legal department and being able to say, what is our current retention schedule? And then reverse engineering that retention schedule into SharePoint. So again, being able to set up that core set of metadata, those core sets of records so that you can have workflows and different things behind the scenes. As we look really through the life cycle, as an author creates a record and as it goes down into classifying or declassifying that record, and there's retention a piece of that, at the end of that retention life cycle, there's a disposition. The records manager, depending on the workflows and depending on the requirements or the type of documents or the, or really the organization itself, what type of file it is, what type of record it is, it can go to many different routes, or maybe it's a contract that has been renewed. Then again, you would change the expiration date or reclassify the document and then go save back within SharePoint. So these are all things that, again, SharePoint in the now, what is capable of SharePoint? Again, I think a lot of the 2007 Moss type of issues have worried some CIOs and some IT directors or the folks in legal compliance. You know, is SharePoint ready for prime time? Can I do DOD 5051, can I do that DOD compliance? Can I go out there and ensure that I'm going to have e-discovery, I'm going to have records pulled and retention and really meet my organization's needs? And not only can you do that with SharePoint, you're also going to save probably 50 to 75% off of licensing compared to an open text solution or compared to a document or FileNet solution. And with that, you're also going to save just an enormous amount of money on the support staff because you don't have to have as many FTEs supporting your SharePoint deployment as you would with those other systems. For example, if we throw out a business problem, how do I prepare for litigation and e-discovery? Looking at SharePoint, and again, this is a lot of organizations are saying this right now. You know, the lawyers have come to us and said, well, we need these X amount of files. There may be paper-based documents, but again, a lot of times there are going to be a lot of e-discovery and electronic items. How do you do this? Really, primary focus should be on the upfront presentation layer, and this really means preparation. And this, you know, when you're preparing for litigation, if you haven't classified the information properly, if you haven't classified the content types and to be able to do those types of metadata and content type applications, you're going to have a difficult time with a litigation and e-discovery. So this is really for, how do you prepare not only during that type of a situation, but really to preempt this. Leverage existing search technologies during the discovery process, custodial-based approach, e-discovery, really doesn't work in a collaborative environment. So once going into that, managing email discovery, SharePoint also allows you to save emails within SharePoint. You can do retention-based searching, keyword searching within SharePoint, and it is 100% integrated within that. So again, you can definitely not only search for specific documents, the content within documents, but also email enabling SharePoint lists and discussion boards to be able to do e-discovery in that manner as well. So not only can you do content management, but also email discovery management as well. In-place records management. So how do you really record, lock down, and really have these record retention policies? To be able to do this, again, there's always going to be specific workflows around records. Every organization is going to have their own process for assigning an item for feedback or going through and once a record is expired, how best does it flow back to a specific area. Declaring a record in SharePoint Designer, so you can actually set, utilizing SharePoint Designer 2010, you can do some of this as well. I wouldn't recommend it for an enterprise. For a small to medium-sized business, I think that SharePoint Designer works well. But once you're getting into the enterprise space, and especially the government space or Fortune 500 space, you really want to stay away from SharePoint Designer at all costs when it comes to records and when it comes to any workflows designated around this type of litigious or e-discovery type type situation. When you're looking at SharePoint, Exchange 14 allows you to archive your email within SharePoint. So if your email is about to, if you have expiration policies within your email, you can then save it right to SharePoint. A lot of organizations are getting away from PSTs because they are such a liability. Sometimes folks will put in their USB drive, take a PSD home just because they want to save their emails over the years. So that's something that you really want to stay away from if you're planning your IT strategy for your organization. A lot of organizations are phasing out PSTs, but you can manage emails within SharePoint. Again, these are multiple phases, so I wouldn't recommend jumping out of the box in phase one of a project and saying I'm going to tackle not only records management, but also email management, getting rid of PSTs. It needs to be a phased approach. And so SharePoint in the now, this webinar, the first six here, is to really give an overview of other topics we will be covering. But I want to give a broad spectrum today of what's possible in SharePoint, what is capable right now to be able to utilize. If you have existing projects going on within your organization, you may want to step back and say, well, SharePoint 2010 out of the box has this capability. So, it may be a case where I don't necessarily want to go forward with a customization project that I have going in SharePoint 2007. Again, it may be best to hold off, upgrade to SharePoint 2010, and use this out-of-the-box functionality. It may save quite a bit of budget going forward. So looking at a couple other issues, how do I scale my compliance solution to the enterprise? If you're looking at that business problem, there's going to be really some different areas to look at. You can scale to hundreds of millions of records within SharePoint. So there's no limitations like there was before to be able to store a specific number of documents within a document library and have these different performance issues. You're, of course, going to need to scale your architecture, your backend architecture. But again, hundreds of millions of documents is not an issue. We've done projects where we've actually migrated petabytes of content into SharePoint. Or multiple terabytes of content. You do need to span them across multiple content databases, multiple site collections, But again, Office 14, you can save right from Word, save right from PowerPoint into SharePoint, be able to utilize the content organizer within SharePoint, apply content types, cross-site collections, and again, that allows you to have your centralized e-discovery searches across all of your sites. Again, if you want to go down another more powerful search route, fast search, that really is a project in itself. It's an extremely powerful solution. I can tell you, out of the 40 or so recent SharePoint 2010 implementations that we have done, I would say about 40% of our clients are rolling out fast, just because, again, they want to get 2010 out there, they want to get their feet wet with it, and then, again, taking on fast as another phase of the project. Looking at a couple other items, again, looking at the SharePoint 2010 stack. So really, content is the major driver within SharePoint. There's all these different pieces of SharePoint. If we look at the new wheel in SharePoint 2010, you're going to have all these different pieces. If we just start with sites, and I'll quickly go around this, but you're going to have SharePoint Workspace. So to be able to take SharePoint offline, be able to back your documents up offline, take them on the airplane, work on them, come back to the office the next day, or come back to another one of your another satellite office within your organization, plug in, sync right back up. So it does offer a full offline capability. That is the new Microsoft group. The new group is actually SharePoint Workspace. SharePoint Mobile, extremely powerful to be able to get on your BlackBerry or your iPhone or your Android and access a mobile document. Actually doing editing of the content. It's just wonderful to be able to be connected. And, it's something that we're seeing slowly but surely increase. A lot of the both private sector and the government sector are getting much, much more into mobile, whether it's iPads or whether it's some of the other devices. They're really looking at that mobile, and there are ways to do secure mobile via certificates and via other elements. Community is just really around the professional networking, social bookmarking, looking at my sites, being able to share best practices. I'll use an example in the oil and gas industry. One of the major oil and gas companies we did a SharePoint 2010 project for, and they wanted to be able to capture best practices and lessons learned to be able to, say, drilling in the North Sea. There was one instance where we actually had a client. They had a drilling issue in the North Sea, and they got on their blog on their My site, and they were on a distribution list. Actually, someone else there was actually stationed in Alaska, which is almost in the other side of the globe. There was able to log in and give advice, and it actually saved X amount of barrels of oil a day. So. There is, a real knowledge management best practices, knowledge management lessons learned type area with that. Going around the rest of the wheel quickly, enterprise content types, but what's really neat is our document sets. To be able to go through document sets, and if you have one major contract, for example, you can actually say these 10 documents are associated with this specific document set. So it really gives you the ability to be able to tie in one document with multiple documents, and once I open up that document, you can click on related documents in the document set, and it will show that there. If you have 500 megabytes CAD drawings, for example, or massive audio video recordings, you can do remote blob storage, so you can still store a link to that document or that file within SharePoint, but still store it remotely within the blob via the blob storage. And also quickly getting around search, social relevance, phonetical search. The Insights platform is the reporting platform that gives it into performance services, KPIs, dashboards, web analytics, Visio services. The real-time Visio services is quite amazing. And then getting up here into composites. And composites is really being able to have the information worker or that kind of that really skilled power user to be able to utilize the different features out of the box in SharePoint to build a site that's going to help them to be able to meet a business need quickly. You know, SharePoint is great about that. If you're talking about level one type support, or support, you know, there's level one, level two. Level two may be more customization or a little more configuration, but what's so great about SharePoint is once you have your governance down and once you templatize your site, you can actually go out there and create a new site, pull in the specific web parts out of your, hopefully your shared web part gallery that you've developed over time, and really meet your client's needs or meet your own needs within your department very quickly. One thing I wanted to look at is this content aspect. And with the content aspect, again, that's one of the more popular items looking at SharePoint in the now that folks are looking at. And it's, again, how do you manage best practices and doing managed metadata and turn sets? And I can't stress enough how important it is to take a hard look at implementing a core metadata strategy. A lot of organizations want to go out there and roll out SharePoint and not put in the time needed, maybe the extra 2 weeks that you need to go out there and actually come up with a core set of maybe 5 content types or 10 content types. It's not easy always to go around to the different departments within your organization and to be able to go out there and get a consensus on a specific set of managed metadata or a metadata model that's going to work for everyone. But I really would encourage you to be able to go out there and put together something that's going to at least cover the main items within your organization. So if we look at that, areas for records management, once you get that metadata in there and you're able to utilize it, you're going to be able to search for documents within tenths of a second. Very, very broad search within seconds. You can search and crawl Office files, PDF files, your scanning documents, OCR documents, being able to do that. Going into crawling other line of business systems, you can actually go crawl your file shares if you'd like, you can crawl other web-based applications, you can crawl other line of business systems. Versioning within document records management, being able to track different versions of documents as you edit the content, being able to go through and track that. And then looking at security, it is extremely secure. Manage at the Active Directory level or manage at the SharePoint security level. Legal, absolutely. It was built around looking at automated management of records retention policies. Looking at auditing, and again, that some of the biggest complaints were, well, I need to roll out document or I need to roll out open text live link because I don't have the right e-discovery or I may have to do some customization in SharePoint to do this. In 2010, that's not the case. You can roll out the out-of-the-box SharePoint 2010 with the right methodologies and with the right consulting services or internal knowledge. To really be able to do this correctly. Also going green, green initiatives that are out there, being able to have a paperless office, also the Freedom of Information Act, having to have documents out there that are scanned or being able to easily be searched. It's really a time-saving area. There's several third parties out there that offer scanning solutions, whether you want to have one central scanner that scans thousands of documents or you just want to have a scanner at your desk to scan a document. But, again, it's extremely powerful. A couple pieces, getting a little more technical here into metadata, but I can't stress enough, if you're rolling out SharePoint now or thinking about rolling out SharePoint, looking at your taxonomy, looking at how you're going to structure your top-level navigation, looking at the core content types. There's a taxonomy aspect of this. There's also a new term and a new technology in SharePoint, which is a folksonomy. Looking at more flexible terms If you don't have real consistency in specific items, you can search for a specific term, and it'll give you really best bets and suggestions around those types of words. So again, it's a smart system. It's really going to allow you to be able to access the system, find your content, and even if you don't know exactly what you're looking for, you can search for it, you can browse for it, you can use several different pieces of functionality within SharePoint to come across that. Why implement metadata? You're going to have a terrible time and really not going to be able to do it. To have expiration dates, you're not going to be able to do true records management without metadata. Archiving of data, for example, if you want to have my sites or if you want to have sites out there and for a project and the project is over, how are you going to then archive that off? And archiving that off and maybe a similar project pops up in another year. How do you want to bring that back? So again, you really need to have the metadata aspect, do the hard work. Again, there's the ROI and putting together a true metadata model for SharePoint and searching and sorting and filtering, it pays dividends. And again, metadata in SharePoint gives you four types of metadata. Document properties associated with the client. It's really coming out of your Office 2007 or Office 2010 documents out of your document information panel. You also have a list of library properties, which again you can set custom columns, or you can go down below and actually set the metadata within that as well. Social tags. There's a managed metadata service and organization into a tag cloud. And that cloud is not the cloud in the cloud sense, but to be able to do the managed metadata service. So if you're looking at a document, say it's an invoice, what's the information around that? What's the metadata, the workflows that may follow? How do you route that through SharePoint? How do you lower the overall time people are taking on approving invoices, getting contracts signed? Do you want to implement digital signatures within SharePoint? Do you want to be able to track your emails? Have incoming faxes come into SharePoint or fax out of SharePoint? All things that are 100% feasible in doing. Also workflows, they tie to content types. So when you have your disposition workflows, your approval workflows, your publishing workflows, these content management and these content type strategies that I'm talking about here, again, will allow you to have really the best of the best records management system in your organization. But again, there is a lot of due diligence. There is a lot of strategies around doing this. But again, it is key when looking at SharePoint and now looking at what was popular, what folks are doing, and it really is around both the content management, records management. When you're looking at the information management policies, you can actually implement specific policies so that certain documents are can have certain not only retention, but you can have barcodes around them. We're just rolling out a project for a customer who has a basement. They're a Fortune 500 company, but in their basement they have boxes and boxes and boxes of documents. And what they've been doing is they've been taking a box and basically tagging it, saying what's in this box, putting a sticker on it with what's in it, and calling Iron Mountain. Iron Mountain comes and picks it up and takes it out to their site. They're paying something, in the millions and millions of dollars a year to manage that, when they can use SharePoint to do the exact same thing. You can have optical character recognition. You can set an invoice down. You can do barcode scanning. You can manage physical assets in SharePoint. So being able to do that, doing labeling. But again, in something like that where you're having millions of paper-based documents. We have done projects with millions of paper-based documents. You're probably going to want to get a centralized scanner. There's
several different vendors out there that have those. You can hire some temporary staff or hire staff to sit there, literally scan, just load this, the scanner up all day. It OCRs the document and routes it into the right document library, and you may look at saving $5 to $10 million a year on an Iron Mountain or a very similar type of service, where again, there's so many different ROI capabilities and ROI savings in SharePoint. It's just a matter of really identifying them, understanding what is out in the 2010 platform. And then I'm getting a little bit in the weeds and a little bit technical here as far as these kind of intricacies of SharePoint, but I think it's important for the audience to understand what's possible. As we go down into the five additional webinars that we're having, myself and other senior members of the EPC group staff will be conducting the other sessions and drilling down on more of these pieces. But again, how can you, it's funny when we're selling these, visiting an SOW, we're getting a lot of clients saying, well, what's the ROI? Well, can you show me tangible ROI? And it is very simple sometimes to show, it took this many hours before SharePoint, and now that you're rolling out SharePoint, you're saving 2,000 hours just on compliance-related activities within a specific division or a specific department. So we've done a lot of ROI studies, and can feel free to reach out to us offline to pick some of that up. I'm going to skip through this quickly and get some more into the meat and potatoes of SharePoint. But again, I wanted to stress this a lot today, just around metadata. Don't skimp on it. Don't go through and skip the management and aspects, or don't go through and not think of your hierarchical collections, because if you have 20 terabytes of content, you're going to have multiple site collections, multiple content databases. You can use managed paths, so the URLs are going to be seamless to the user. It's not going to affect them whatsoever as far as usability, as far as performance, if you architect it correctly. A couple other things to be able to do keywords. And this is pretty neat, to be able to go in and put keywords and to be able to utilize the folksonomies that I talked about earlier. But you may, one organization, or if you're looking at large organizations, or if you're looking at the federal government, you're just acronym heavy. I mean, just imagine the amount of acronyms. And in a given organization, people may refer to one specific task or operating company or one area with multiple acronyms. So you can actually set in SharePoint a document or one department and have multiple acronyms and have multiple different ways to pick those types of elements. So again, I'm just giving you some of the high-level points of what is possible. The managed metadata service, the content type hub, this goes into if you have a global deployment, if you're deploying SharePoint to 20 different countries. We did last year a large oil and gas company where we did, I believe, around 30-plus countries. And they were saying, well, how do we go out there and really do manage the content type hubs? And what happens if we have a change within our metadata? How do we go push that out? There's web services within SharePoint that you can actually go out there, do some find and replace type activities to be able to manage that from that level. So there's not a worry about what happens if a department gets renamed or something gets reorged. And again, this is skipping down into this. We're going to share some of these presentations after the call here. So I'm going to skip down a little bit just for time's sake and kind of get into looking at some of the SharePoint sites and really what can be managed within SharePoint. So if we look at SharePoint sites in particular in 2010, absolutely easy editing, including theming and branding. When we're looking at branding, in the 2007 realm, a lot of users or power users used SharePoint Designer 2007 to modify the master page, to go out there and do customizations. SharePoint Designer 2010 is much more, is much better about not affecting the site. But I've been doing SharePoint since it was called Tahoe, and I have to be honest, SharePoint Designer scares the heck out of me. So it's really good for very simple workflows. It's very good for very simple type of actions out there. But again, when you're talking about enterprise, when you're talking about large Fortune 500 government organizations, you really need to look more towards the Visual Studio approach, or looking towards more of is there a shared web part or workflow or a master page in your organization that you can utilize? And again, we talked about some mobile access, cross-browser support. But again, really what folks are accessing this for is a single platform that does collaboration, content management, intranet, extranet, internet-facing sites, and again, interoperability improvements across the board. Going into rapid creation of web content, pervasive records management, and less storage bandwidth. And we have a lot of clients that have high latency, low bandwidth sites across the globe. And with SharePoint 2010, it is much more improved. So if you have a site in Africa, if you have a site, in theater somewhere, maybe in overseas in the Middle East, to be able to access that content, there's several different things that you can do in SharePoint to be able to speed that along. There's third-party tools out there. There's things you can do internally with SharePoint. But again, there's even a very simple interoperability with legacy platforms. It was the BBC. Now it's called the BCS. But you can actually go through, and I like to call it the ultimate API, because you can go through, connect with your legacy repositories, and use SharePoint as the one-size-fits-all, really the piece to manage all of your content. Another neat thing about SharePoint is managing digital assets. Being able to manage videos, training videos, photographs, geological type images, old maps, all of these different things that you may not think that SharePoint can do. We've had firms that have uploaded all of their training materials to SharePoint and now stream them and have being able to record who's actually out there viewing them. There's media players embedded. Not only so reliant, but you can utilize Flash as well as other media solutions as well. Doing recordings, we've seen a lot of presidents of companies do streaming weekly type of messages to the audience. It's just a really neat way to get the message out to the masses. Managing documents in 2010. A lot of revised features, the document sets, like I said. The content organizer is an out-of-the-box tool to allow you to organize your content after the fact. You can have location-based metadata default. So if you have 12 different locations in the United States, or if you have global organizations, you can go out there and give specific metadata and in that specific language. There's 20 or 30 plus language packs out there that you can utilize. The document sets are huge. And again, these are things that we're seeing every day out there that people are asking for and saying, how do I manage multiple contracts? How do I manage documents that have 15 or 20 different documents associated with it? So making you aware of this is my goal here in this first webinar. Again, we can provide you with this information after the call, but I think it's very important to realize what's capable and what is really available to the audience out there. And again, I'll save some of these slides for the next webinar, but I want to skip down and cover just a couple different pieces here within SharePoint. When we're looking at the SharePoint Insights platform, SharePoint Insights is really the reporting area of SharePoint. Doing visual scorecards. These visual scorecards can be connected to external systems. This can be Oracle Financials. This can be custom. This can even be Access Database. Definitely recommend against it, but it could be pulling right in from SQL Server. pulling in Project Server 2007 or Project Server 2010. We utilize the KPIs within our sites, our project workspaces, being able to do trending within this. But again, the Insights platform with Performance Point Services, which is free with SharePoint Server 2010 Enterprise. It is just an amazing thing, and it's neat to see a lot of times executives may not always know why is our sales or why is there an issue in a specific area. You can actually double-click on this if you make it interactive, drill down to actually find out why exactly is this specific, why are we down in a specific area or why we have issues around a specific topic. So it's really neat to be able to see, this being used out there. Another amazing piece of the SharePoint Insights is real-time Visio. In Redmond, I got the screenshot from Microsoft. Basically, they actually manage their SAN within a Visio diagram. And these are actually real-time reports. So you can actually see what servers are up, what servers are down. I've also seen this on colleges using maps to be able to map streets, being able to map roads. Of course, you use this with just a lot of different things. But with this, it's just amazing how you can actually go through and to be able to really manage real-time Visio within SharePoint. A couple other pieces here. I wanted to show the powerful nature of being able to do data slicing. So not only can you have reports on the screen, you can actually go through here and, this is showing shipping preference. But if you wanted to say by vertical, by defense, if you wanted to say by aerospace, if you wanted to say by manufacturing, it'll actually change the screen. Or you can go down through your different clients, and as you select clients, it'll actually update the different pieces here. So these web parts can actually be tied together within SharePoint. So it's just an extremely powerful way to be able to not only have a platform that provides you with collaboration, provides you with document management, but also is your one-stop shop for really all your information. To be able to really say to your employees or say to your folks, this is the tool that we use. When you go in the morning, you turn on your laptop, you turn on your desktop, you're going to go to your SharePoint departmental site. You're going to have all the information on your screen to do your job. If you want to send out a paper-based request in the past, now you just log in and fill out an InfoPath form. You click apply, it routes it over. Just amazing how, it saves multiple days on getting contracts signed, on getting different pieces of information signed. So it is quite powerful. Couple other pieces here as we run out of time. I know we have just a couple more minutes here, but being able to utilize creating workflows. This is a SharePoint Designer workflow, and, I joke that SharePoint Designer is a tool that can be scary, and that's really just because of lack of governance. We do a lot of governance initiatives, but it's really important to have specific governance around SharePoint Designer, make it only available to a very small audience of skilled SharePoint folks, your power users, your SharePoint administrators, your site collection owners, because they can do a little bit of damage with it. You can also always go back and reset the sites, but you may lose data. But if you're doing simple workflows, just multiple approver or some things like that, it's not a bad tool for very easy to very low intermediate type solutions. Data validation, a couple more pieces to be able to see real time before you. When you create something, before you save it, you can actually view it and view the part. But one other piece I wanted to touch on when it comes to Visio is you can actually create a flowchart or a workflow in Visio and upload it into SharePoint. So you don't need SharePoint Designer necessarily. You can actually go in, and if you're proficient with Visio, you create, go through here, send an email. Once the email goes out, assign a task, a to-do task, update the list with the relevant information about the task. It actually goes through and it marks through the steps. Once you create that video with this workflow, you go into SharePoint, you upload, or you just really send it and right into SharePoint, and actually creates real-time workflows in SharePoint via Visio 2010. So they're very cool stuff. A couple other pieces, you can do custom event receivers. There are some pretty nice ways to be able to customize SharePoint. This is getting more into the advanced pieces where, again, you really need to have a pretty good understanding of SharePoint's best practices development, having your development environment. Don't ever do any type of this work in production. Always have sandboxes and a very governed way to deploy. I also recommend having a SharePoint review committee within your organization that reviews all solutions. Just today on the App Store, Google pulled a handful of apps on the App Store because of malware. So, you can imagine Google's QA process, and if you look at your QA process in your organization, it's just better to better safe than sorry. So really go through and try to, have a review committee or sit down and have a second pair of eyes, take a look at really what you're trying to accomplish. And again, this just shows how you can pull line of business data across from all sorts of different areas, and you can do searching on it, and whether it's SQL Server, other line of business, whether it's relational databases, it really allows for some really neat pieces there. So I believe we have about 4 minutes remaining. Do have a couple questions here, and let me go ahead and pause here, and I will go ahead and answer a couple questions here. Okay, this user is asking about Documentum, and basically saying they have a Documentum implementation that they've used for about 5 years, and they're wanting to know the life cycle of a replacement of Documentum. Something like that, is obviously a project that I would really say to, we recommend a lot of phase zeros to really level set. Take a look at what exactly you're trying to accomplish with your with SharePoint. How are you actually going about implementing a new records management system? It does take, possibly you can utilize the same content types and utilize the same metadata strategies from the Documentum. But again, you can, there's obviously a lot of licensing savings. There's obviously a lot of internal staffing savings as well. But I would definitely recommend taking a look at the full spectrum, getting legal and compliance involved, getting the key stakeholders there. That's usually a very political issue within the organization, depending on who purchased the licensing or how long the just being driven by the CIO or the IT director or the CFO, and they're really looking at not only cost savings, but maybe they're becoming more and more of a Microsoft type shop. And I think that is something where, again, you can really leverage SharePoint to do some cost savings. We had about 100 and some questions, so I got one whole question, so I apologize, but we will save these, and actually I'll personally answer them offline for everyone. I just want to thank everyone for joining, and our next upcoming webinar will be on March 31st, and basically on SharePoint version control. Weighing the comparisons and really going through and weighing and comparing SharePoint's version functionality, major and minor versions. How do you actually 1.0, 2.0, 3.0, how do you manage the content storage versions and how you actually go through and integrate with other Office systems and other Office platforms in doing version management. We'll go into a little bit more into some of the document capabilities of the different Office 2010 and Office 2007 platforms. April 7th, we're going to cover My Sites and go through My Site governance, really go through all those different pieces around why roll out My Sites, really how risky is it and who's doing it. We're going to have a couple of real-world case studies from clients that we're large clients that we've rolled out My Sites. April 28th, how do I get there? Looking at the SharePoint migration strategies, I would really recommend taking a look at that or reaching out. You don't necessarily need to go out and buy a $30,000 third-party migration tool. Again, we're agnostic when it comes to third-party vendors, but a great deal of the upgrades we're doing are using the attach or one of the different methods of upgrade. May 12th, maximizing your investment. We're going to look at SLAs and chargeback models. How do you actually go through and, you know, once you've got your SharePoint investment out there, it's going to continue to snowball. It's going to cross multiple departments. You're going to get flooded with requests. You may need to hire additional staff or full-time employee, you know, more FTEs, more developers. You may need to buy additional hardware. So, again, is IT going to be funding this entire operation at SharePoint, or do you need to charge departments $5,000, $10,000 a year, or is it by the user? We have some different examples that are good. A couple different clients that have been nice enough to allow us to share their chargeback models and what we've kind of worked with them on. And then May 26th, we're going to have about seven EPC group experts from architecture to develop to design to PMO, how to manage projects, how to go through and really anything and everything. So we're going to start gathering questions really probably mid-April on that. But that's going to be something where we're going to have folks submit questions. And again, we're going to go out there and answer real-life questions. So it's maybe a pseudo-free consulting effort or a consulting webinar. So again, I appreciate everyone joining today. And again, thank you for your time and look forward to seeing you on the next webinar. Everyone have a great day.